So hi all. This is the topic which I'm going to present now. So this is SN IoT is for security. So going to the next slide. Who am I? I am Akriti. Oh yeah, a little Swedish. Thanks to Google Translate. So I'm Akriti. I work for Adobe Systems, and I'm from India, Bangalore. Because the time is too less, so I just need to rush up. So agenda of my talk is the rise of IoT, why there is rise of IoT, just two lines for it. Then why IoT, why people are crazy for IoT. Then we are going some, through some infamous cases of insecurity in IoT with demo. And then we will have a briefing of the loopholes which we have discussed in the previous cases. But before I present, move ahead with my presentation, there is a small disclaimer that all these things which I'm going to present now, they are the opinions of my mind. So they do not any way reflect the opinions of my employer. So keep the employer away from it. Only the slides are there. I got from them. So just two lines for rise of IoT. As Dan has also told about the rise of IoT, but I found another stat which was given by Intel. So it's a two-line and very nice which they have given. So it's like IoT is growing at a breathtaking pace. So 2 billion objects were there in 2006, and it's projected to increase to 200 billion in 2020, and there will be around 26 smart objects per person on this earth. Then we have charm of IoT, why people are mad for IoT. So it's for comfort by automation. We have home automation system. I forgot to switch off the home some appliance, and I simply go back. I'm in the office. I no need to rush back to my home. I can simply, switch on my mobile phone, and I can just log into app, and I can switch off the device from there. Then improve decision making. We have smart thermostats here, so which take real time input, like what's the temperature outside, what's the weather, the time, the day. Accordingly, they adjust the temperature. Then we have efficient tracking. So we are aware of Fitbits. We are aware of GPS trackers. So they keep a lot of sensitive information about a person. So when we are handling over the controls of our home and other crucial assets, we will definitely get halted by a question, which is, so you think you are secure? So even though IoT looks promising, you can see the large amount of gadgets they provide, smart locks, baby monitors, smart DVRs, then also we get haunted by this question. So I will make sure that the upcoming slides will make it clear that why we get this question in our mind. But before I start off with these things, I just want to make sure the goal of the presentation. The goal of the presentation is to convey that we should be secure, we should be aware of security flaws which are found in devices. It's not to scare you off from IoT. IoT is a real good thing. We should be updated with time. But yes, we should keep security concerns also in mind. So both we, end users, as well as device manufacturers. So these are some infamous cases which we are going to talk about. So they are, I know what you did last summer. The treasure is in the firmware. All colors will agree in the dark. So I know what you did last summer. So is there any third eye which is creeping track, which is keeping track of us, what we are doing? So yeah, you are somewhat close to it. So the subject of this demo is a DVR camera. And in Arsenal, we have Nmap, Kali Linux, browser, VLC player, very simple attack. Nothing James Bond kind of thing. So the synopsis of this attack, which is done, is that simply the DVR can be plugged into the network. You need to look out for the vulnerable services running, and you need to attack one of the services, and you will be able to get the streams. So let's add Mr. Vice DVR. So I'm having a video for it. Are you guys able to see what it's projecting there properly? OK. So I'll take it as a yes. So before I start off with my with this demo, there's a thing that if you see the screen, so it is divided into two parts. So one is the screen of mine, and another is the screen for the setup. And let me make a small story, background story. So one of my colleagues got a job from my manager that he has to set up an appraisal quiz for us. Now, me and my teammates are eager enough to sneak into his laptop and see what questions he is putting for us. So we know that the place where he sits, it's monitored by a surveillance camera. And that surveillance camera is connected to this DVR. And this DVR is plugged into the network. And I'm also in the same network. So OK, let's use network pen test methodologies here. So we are going to use that. And the first step is to find out the live IPs. So Nmap was taking a bit long in counting out the IPs, and then suddenly it was crumpling all the results. So I have to cut out that waiting time just for your convenience so that I could finish in time. So if you see, I'm running Nmap, and I'm trying to find out all the live IP, and I'm saving it in live host, live.txt. So it was taking a lot of time, so I have to cut short the video. And before I move to next step, so it's like when it was showing all the results of the live IPs, so it was showing that something ended with 192 was DVR's IP. That was up. So let's check whatever I'm saying is correct or not. So let's grep 192 term here. Yeah. So we see that this IP is off DVR. So what next we can do? In network pen testing, if we have performed network pen testing, then the second step is to find all the vulnerable services running. Let's see what services are running. Enumerate that. So I'll start that. So simple Nmap scan for this, Nmap-V. And then we have this IP. OK, we are getting some results. And if you see, I have highlighted 554. There are many more ports there, 554, 80, 23, 8000, 5000. But this 554 catches interest of us, because 554 is for RTSP, that is real-time streaming protocol, which manages the connection, manages and establishes the connection between two endpoints for real-time data streaming. So we got this port there. So yeah, it's of use to us. What we can do, we can open up VLC player, or in browser also we can do the same thing. So to catch up the RTSP stream, there is a format which I'll show. So in VLC, we have an option of capture open network stream. It's a little bit not clear here, but if you see in VLC, when you have a file there, you have open media, open network streams. You click on that, you'll get this kind of window. So there is a network tab there, and you have to put this kind of URL there. So the URL goes like this, rtsp:// the IP for that particular device, and the port number, /live/ch02. So here, 02, there's one more thing here, that it's a nomenclature. Like when we have ch02, that means it corresponds to the camera 3. So if it is 01, it is corresponding for camera 2. So I was knowing that in DVR, there were 8 streams. So I'm giving a hit and try. Let's see where we are going to get streams. So I'm trying here with channel 2. OK, I'm not able to get anything here. OK, I'm again trying the same process. I'm trying to give channel 3. No luck. OK, this time it should work. 00. Bingo. I'm having the stream, and I'm able to see what my colleague is doing. I'm able to see that this streaming, which is there on the DVR's interface, that's coming on my laptop as well. So thus, I can sneak into my senior's computer, and I can see what's happening here. So that is one case which we have seen. Don't worry, I will be reviewing about the loopholes which were present here. Then the next case which we are going through is the treasure is in the firmware. So firmware, as in the previous presentation, Dan has also spoken, default passwords, and these are deadly. These are deadly mistakes. Same it is. So we are going to talk about the firmware analysis here. So firmware, basically, if we are able to extract the file systems of a firmware, we'll definitely get access to all the files. And yeah, we can try to dig up some sensitive details from it. So in this case, the subject was a smart plug. And the arsenals we have used was Kali Linux, Nmap, John the Ripper. Jadex we haven't used in the demo, but I can tell where you can use it. Then we have Binwalk. Then there was a smart plug, which was controlled by mobile apps. And the thing which we did was we got the firmware. And let's see what we could do with this information, how we are going to work with this firmware. So if you see my screen, so we have three So we have three files here, relay.cgi, switch.bin, and wordlist.txt. So relay, the switch.bin is a firmware binary with us. And then we have wordlist.txt, so in case we get password hashes, so just in case we get, so just to crack them, we have wordlist.txt. Relay.cgi, I'll tell later, in case if you want to remotely control the plug, you can use this. So we'll try to extract the file system out of this binary file. So we will be using binwalk for it. So we have binwalk hyphen e switch.bin. So hyphen e switch stands for extracting of the file system. So we are trying to extract. And we see it's a LZMA compression done here, and it's a squashfs file system. So a squashfs file system is a small, tiny Linux, which is compressed Linux, we can say, for embedded systems. So if it is a squashfs system, so the major folder which will be of interest to us is squashfs. However, there are many files here when we do ls. So we can try out one thing. Let's see if they, I mean, we'll try to get into the squashfs folder. CD squashfs hyphen root. OK, let's see. Yeah, so you can see it's very much similar to the Linux file system. And we see etc is there, dev is there. A lot of file structures are there which are in Linux. So now you must be, I think we are on the same page. You must be getting the same idea which I'm getting now. OK, we have access to etc. Let's see what next we can do. Let's find out the password hashes which are stored in the shadow file. So let's see, we are having password file and shadow file here. Yeah, so we move in etc. Yeah, it looks that it's there. Again, let's see. Cat password. So we have all these users here. Cat shadow. This is the password hash. OK, so now we have got the password hash. Now let's see if we can crack it. So for cracking, as I have told you, that we are having wordlist.txt there, so which has been already prepared for assisting John the Ripper. And before cracking, we will be also requiring an unshadow file. So we have this unshadow file with us, unshadow pass. I mean, we have to prepare that. So unshadow file is a combination of both password and the shadow file. And we are storing it in a file name unshadow. So just for my convenience, I'll be moving that into the firmware folder. Where I was working earlier, there, relay.bin and other files were present. So yeah, I have done it there. So now let's start John the Ripper. Let's see, are we successful enough to crack the hash? So yeah, John hyphen hyphen word list, and we gave that word list, which we have prepared earlier, and we give that unshadow file as the input parameter. So yeah, it worked. So if you must have seen, it worked quite quick here, but in real-time scenario, it took a couple of days to do it. And thanks to anits.com, we were able to get the passwords by their help. So when we do John hyphen hyphen show and we do unshadow, then we see root and the password related to it. So this is a firmware analysis that we are able to get the default hard-coded password from it. Now also, if you download this firmware, you will be getting the same password. That's for sure. So this is a password. Now let's see where we are going to use this password. So this, in this setup, if you see, this is the smart plug, which is connected. And this is my mobile phone connected to it. So if I'm able to switch it on, this will start glowing that, OK, this much charging is done. And if I switch it off, it will show that, OK, charging is, I mean, it will go off. The display will go off. So, and this smart plug acts in two modes, that is access point mode and a station mode. So we will be demonstrating on access point mode. However, it can be done on station mode as well. So we'll try to connect to its network. So I started typing without connecting to the network, then I got reminded. OK. OK, so this is OKSP3 network. I'm trying to connect to it. That's the network of this smart plug. OK, I'm waiting for a while to see it's getting connected or not. Seems like it got connected. OK, so and this is not clear, so that's why I've written in text box there that was the IP of this gateway. So gateway will be the IP of this smart plug. So it was 192.168.10.253. So I'm again running a nmap to enumerate all the services running. And let's see where we can use that password. So yeah, you can see that we are going good. 22, SSH. So yeah, SSH will ask for password. Let's see, it's going to ask which password now. And we know there were like 4 users there. Obviously, it will be asking for root password. So it's asking the root password, which we have with us. Let's put it here. Yes, so we are able to get an entry into this shell of this smart plug. So what next? What else we can do? So let's try to control the switch. But yeah, there's a minus point. We should be in the same network. Even if it is in station mode, we should be in the same Wi-Fi network. So yeah, I'm able to migrate into the directories. OK, so here comes a point why we have relay.cgi. So that's a CGI file, again, thanks to nits.com. So they have created a nice script from where we can remotely control the smart plug. So this is that script. So we are going to copy this script and put it into cgi-bin. We'll put it there. Let's see what next is going to happen. So through this, we will be setting the relay switch input that 1, it will turn on. And when if it is off, I mean, 0, so it should turn off. So we are trying to SSH into it again. And we give the same password. And navigate to cgi-bin. We'll copy that same file here. Sorry, my typing is very bad. OK, so we got it here, saved. Now let's just change its permission so that we can execute it from outside. Chmod 755, relay.cgi. Now I'll open up my Firefox browser. And I'll see whether I'm able to control it from outside or not. So this is my Firefox. OK, I'm trying to type on this URL here. So this is my plugs IP slash the directory where I have saved this relay.cgi. And I'm passing the parameter on. So if I pass parameter on, it will pass 1 to that file. So if you see, it has switched on. Now the turn to switch it off. So I'm passing the off parameter here. And if you see here, it goes off. So you must be thinking that that's a minus point. We need to be connected to the same network. But the thing is that we wanted to focus on the firmware analysis here. So the main thing is that, yes, we can find out the sensitive details if we try to dig into the files, I mean, firmware files. So that was a concern which we wanted to show here. So we have case number 3 with us. All colors will agree in the dark. So this is somewhat related to the real life incidents, and it happened with me. So I brought a smart bulb, which was connected, which can be controlled by Bluetooth, and I got it some years back, I mean, 1 year back. And I can just change the color according to the ambience I need. But one day, I felt that it started acting spooky. I thought that I haven't triggered any control or I haven't triggered any this thing, color change. But it was like flickering. So many colors were appearing there in that bulb. So yeah, first it looked spooky. But then I thought that somebody else is trying to control it. So I have to unplug it and took it with my friends. So we started analyzing it. So let's see what we are going to do with that. So there's a small demo for this. So if you see this device is plugged in here. And then we have my screen here. So I'm starting up with the demo. So one more thing was there that in the arsenals, I missed on that. Sorry for that. So I have used CSR 4.x. So because my laptop was not having BLE, it wasn't supporting BLE, so I have to get a dongle for it. So it was a cheap dongle, which I have used. So I have used CSR 4.0 dongle. And I have used this Kali Linux again. So I'm trying to see whether I'm able to connect to that dongle or not. So yeah, when both of these interfaces should come, then this means that it's properly connected. So HCI1 and HCI0 should come properly. So in HCI1, I got my USB adapter connected. And let me check in this VMware's removable device also. Yeah, it's connected. So what I want to see now, I want to see whether my this bulb is advertising or not. So Bluetooth bulbs advertise. So I'm trying to check that. So I'm using a CI tool for it, which is used for scanning of the Bluetooth devices. So I'm trying to run an LE scan here. So SCI tool, hyphen LE scan. And I see a lot of Bluetooth devices which are advertising. And which the one which I have highlighted is the one, the Bluetooth address of my device. I'll be dealing with this Bluetooth device now. OK, let's go ahead. Let's see what's going to happen now. So I'll be using GAT tool. And GAT tool comes along with the Kali Linux kernel, BlueZ stack of Bluetooth. So Kali Linux is quite handy, I should say. So we have GAT tool, hyphen I for interactive mode. And I'm trying to connect to that Bluetooth address of my device. It's attempting to connect. And yeah, it got connected successfully. So you can see that it didn't put up any phrase or pin for connecting. So that's the wrong thing. And that's how that guy was able to control my Bluetooth bulb, even though he didn't pay for that bulb, which I paid for. So we have help here. So it's quite good with Kali Linux. We have help options here. So help, I want to see what that guy did next. So I want to see what all characteristics this Bluetooth bulb is having with it. And which one is controlling the color of the bulb. So let me scroll down. I see care-disk. I'm sure I'm not having pointer here, but care-disk is there, which can help us to read all the characteristics which are used for this Bluetooth device. And you can see the handle IDs as well as the corresponding UUIDs to it. So again, it will take a lot of time to analyze all these devices, all of these characteristics. You can see a lot of them are there. So what we did, because of our analysis, we were knowing that which one is the handle. So I'll show you here, highlighted, that which one is dealing with the color. Yeah, so this one is dealing with the color 0x002B. So OK, this means we can do something with it now. Again, type to help. I need to see what else we can do now. So now I need to confirm in front of you guys whatever I'm saying is correct, that handle is indeed for that color controlling thing. So we have care read hyphen handle. So from where you can get the handles, data access, value access, you can say. So I'm trying to run that here. Oh, I need to clear the screen so that you guys can see less of mess. So we have care-read-handle, and we need to give handle value as a parameter here. Bingo, we got this. So this is having a value D0FFFFFF. So D0 is a kind of character they appended in front of the value, but this is the hex value of white. And if you see, this is giving a color white. So from here, we can see that, OK, this is the character for changing of the color. OK, now I'll try to do what that guy did. I'll try to change the color of my bulb. OK, how I can do that? So we have care write cmd command for that, which from where we can write a new value to the handle. So we are going to do that again. OK, I want to give it a color green. So this is the handle value. And this D0 we have to append, as I told. That's a string they have appended. And 008080 is for green. And you can see the color changes to green. So this was the demo of the Bluetooth bulb, how that guy was able to control my house Bluetooth bulb. And the flickering, which I told about, that was this. So there's kind of Python script from which we can show. Isn't it looking spooky? OK. So this guy was able to do that because it's thing. So now this is a briefing of the cases which we have seen so far. So these were the vulnerabilities. Not only these three vulnerabilities are in IoT device, there are many more. So just in reference to the previous vulnerabilities, I will be speaking on them. So using default passwords hard-coded in the firmware, that's not a good idea. Yeah, but we have no other option. So what we can do, we can just simply encrypt the firmware with a good algorithm. That's a thing which we can do. and no authentication enabled. So you must have seen in the, that DVR camera. So RTSP was not having authentication enabled. So what should have happened that when you were typing RTSP:/IP and all those things, then as soon as you hit enter, it should show a pop-up which will come along with username and password. So the server should authenticate your entry for that stream. And another thing that, yeah, network sniffing can be possible again. So what you can do, we can use secure RTP. So that's kind of HTTPS for RTP. So it passes through encrypted channel, those streams. So another thing is Bluetooth. So in Bluetooth also, we see that most of the devices, they don't take authentication. I mean, they don't put up pins or passphrase. So that's not a good idea. But yeah, we don't need military brand security for all of the devices, but yeah, which are crucial to us, we need. And in some of the cases, they can be something like smart locks or something, which may be very crucial to us. So there, yes, we should make sure that all these things are present. Then we have design flaws. So in design flaws, it's like one of the DVR which we were researching on. So we saw that an admin can configure the FTP details where he will be storing all his logs, configuration data, and other things. But the thing is that he has to hit a REST point for putting up the FTP details there. And that REST endpoint used to ask for a token. So he used to put that token, and yeah, it used to do all this work. Now, it used to only check whether the token is present or not, and just used to check whether this is authenticated or not. It never used to check it is having that privilege to do that job. So I was a low privileged user. I was able to configure that FTP details. So that's not a good thing. Then most of the time, we have seen that a lot of unnecessary services are running. It's, when it is not required, that, then remove it. Why to keep it there? So that's another point. And yes, most of the time, people, like mostly in Chinese devices, we have seen that they put a backdoor there. So if, even if you take up this smart plugs, what was the use of SSH here? Yeah, they should they could have controlled this, I can understand. But that was acting as a backdoor. So it was a treasured firmware for us. So yeah, so these were a few cases. And to count on another cases which I can say is a smart bell. So you must have heard about Ring. So that was a very famous smart bell which can, which was connected to Wi-Fi, which can capture the videos of the person who is standing right in front of your door. So the researchers, they have done a very great thing there. So it was like they just pressed the reset button, and that bell started acting as an access point. So you can connect to that access point and simply log in, no need to log in. It was open Wi-Fi of that access point. Just go there, hit an endpoint, something slash config. You can see a XML config file appearing in front of you that was having Wi-Fi credentials, SSID, and password, and Wi-Fi credentials of which it was earlier connected. So the resetting means that you should flush out the old files and plus the sensitive data which have been earlier stored. This thing wasn't done there. So it was a big hack and quite speculated. So this was my talk about. So my talk, again, I'd like to say that, yeah, IoT is a need of future. Yes, we should be updated. We are not in early man stage, so we should update ourselves. But the thing is that, yeah, we should be aware, both us and users, as well as manufacturers of the devices. They should implement all these things in design and implementation. That's all I want to say for now. Thank you. This is queries. If any of you are having, please just do post it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Akriti. Wow. This is giving you nightmares, isn't it? I mean, what you can do with not too much. Sorry, I'm just
no issues.
Borrow space from you. Well, we have got some queries for you,
okay.
Of course, in our question and answer session. So this, we will begin with this. In your experience, how often is the firmware for IoT devices encrypted or cryptographically signed?
Yeah, most of the time I've observed that. So actually, we were trying to prepare for one of our conference. So we were going through various CTFs also. So there I have seen that they were having firmware of microwave, firmware of washing machines. They were like, what to say, highly encrypted. And we were thinking, what is this? We are not able to extract the file system. So that was appearing in CTF, you can see. So most of the time, yes, even the cameras also have nowadays encrypted, which are of good companies. Like you can take example of Google's Nest and other good device companies. So definitely they come encrypted. So they can't compromise with their security.
So there is some hope then?
Yeah, we can say. But yeah, it can be broken as well. Encryption, we can't rely on. Like security is not 100%. We can come closer to it, but as Eric said in the meeting, that it's like something going away and we are running after it again, it goes away. Yeah. So it comes out like that.
So how did you extract the firmware from the IoT device?
Okay, so from IoT device, how we extracted the firmware? Most of the time, let me take example of this smart plug, which I have told just now. So this firmware, it can be done in a way that it was having APK. So I downloaded the APK. So where I got that APK? That was in a booklet I got with that smart plug. And that smart plug told that this is an APK download from here. I got that APK. We decompiled it. And from there, we got the this path for this firmware. From there, we downloaded it. So this is one of the case. But yeah, most of the time, hackers, they find out the firmware. They upload it. Most of the time, manufacturers also upload it on internet. But yeah, most of the time they keep it secret so that other people are not knowing that what is there in their firmware. Hmm.
And what would be the best path towards more secure IoT devices? I mean, you have been touching on this already, but
yeah. So as I told in my talk, that it's the responsibility of all of us to be aware. First of the thing is that, as Dan also told, that we should have proper security trainings. So to keep manufacturers and device developers and other guys who are involved in this process of making IoT devices, they should be aware of the security concerns which are emerging now. And security is a big thing. Data confidentiality, that's a big, big asset for us now. And yes, another thing is that we as end user, we should also be knowing that what we are going for before handing over the crucial aspects to them. Should know what we are going for, and we should know it's secure enough. And yeah, we can't say that it's 100% secure, because obviously one day they'll come up with some zero-day exploit. So we can't just say, but yeah, we can try to remain as aware as we can. That's what I
can say. Would you say it's a valid argument to, I'm old and conservative, to say I don't need to connect my toaster to the internet?
No. That's bad. Then we should not connect our computer as well to the internet. We should shut it down. That will safeguard our computer. So, no.
Well, no, it's not valid. I agree. So are people aware? I mean, you can see that. Can someone read the numbers from this poll where there's a question whether people have IoT devices in their networks? Robert? 60% say it. And how many knows? 30% say, no, we don't have any IoT devices. Do you think people are aware if they do have it or not?
I didn't get you, sorry.
So do you think people are aware whether they have IoT devices in the network or not?
Yeah, I should say that if you have some kind of craziness to hack on those devices, okay, you feel like, okay, let's see what's in network. So definitely I'll try to, like you have seen in my demo that, okay, I wanted to find out the IP of that DVR. So I just had a nmap scan to see, okay, where is this DVR? So I got that IP. So we can say, yeah, if somebody is having a little knowledge of these kind of hacks, they will definitely go for it. Mm-hmm. They'll try to. Curiosity is the main thing. So if you're curious, you will definitely try to search for it.
Yeah, okay. And people who are running the networks are, do you think they are in the state of control that they know every single device that is connected to the internal network?
They should know.
They should know, yeah, but do they you think they do?
That depends on how they have been trained. Or
I won't push you any further. Thank you very much, Akriti. And as a token for our appreciation, we want to hand over this certificate and a small book with Swedish traditions. Thank you very much.